phone. Ring, 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 banana phone. I've got this feeling so appealing for us to get together and sing, sing. Ring, 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 banana phone.
Hey, they did a great job, didn't they? Isn't that fantastic? What a powerful story. You know, isn't it great just sometimes to get the background of a song like that, just to know, listen, this guy was going through some stuff, and as a result of that, God birthed in a song that helps us even today. Some almost 250 years later, God is still using that to minister to us. Well, we're in a series called Green Bananas. Hit your neighbor and say, Green Bananas. How many of y'all did y'all eat your banana? How many of y'all ate your banana? How many of y'all made banana bread? A couple people made banana bread. I love some banana pudding. And nothing like, I'm not talking about the fake stuff. I'm talking about real grandma banana pudding that's been sitting for like 2 weeks, you know, and make your tongue slap your brain. Tastes so good. I grew up in the 80s, 70s and 80s, and I know I'm old. I know I only look like I'm 24, but I really am almost 44. I'll be 44 in just a couple of weeks. My wife and I argued about that the other day. She goes, "You're not going to be 44." And sweetheart, I was born in 1969, and this year I will be 44 years old. And man, I know that's old, ancient. But let me tell you something cool about being old. You remember the old cartoons. How many old cartoon fans do I have out there? I'm talking Saturday morning. I'm not talking about some sponge with pants on. That's not a real cartoon. I'm talking Tom and Jerry. I'm talking Popeye. I'm talking, you know, I'm just a bill up on Capitol Hill. Y'all remember that? How many of y'all remember like Wile E. Coyote and the Roadrunner? I always used to think, a couple things you used to think about that. First of all, where in the world did he get all the money in the desert to buy all that stuff to chase that Roadrunner? How did they get this stuff there? It ain't like he had an address or anything like that. And why would he be chasing a skinny little bird like that? This weighed all of 6.5 pounds. One of the things I loved about those commercials those cartoons, is that I love the fact that they would always have a banana peel situation. You remember when they would put the banana peel on the ground and somebody would have just an epic fall? They would hit it, you know, maybe the Roadrunner would put it in front of him, he would hit it, he would up in the air, and Wile E. Coyote would always have like 1,400 pounds of TNT on him, strapped to him, getting ready to do something, and he would hit that banana peel, slide up in the air, and just fall flat on his back and blow up, and then just live to chase the Roadrunner another day. When I think about this, I think about how many times the enemy has tried to put a banana peel in my way. Maybe in your way. But here's the thing. Maybe we need to get some perspective on how God can take what we think has caused us to slip and fall. God can turn it around for good. That he can take, and maybe there's some purpose in that peel. I don't know. Maybe your slip is really God's setup for you. I want to talk about that today. I want to talk about how in the middle of our storms, if we have just a little bit of perspective, it might help us make it through the storm. That's what Green Bananas is all about. It's about us understanding in the middle of our trial, in the middle of the process of time, that we can understand what God is trying to do in us and through us. James 1, listen to this verse. You can turn over to Mark 4, and I'll get there in a minute. James 1 says this. This is one of those verses that when you read it, you don't really like it, but whenever I say that out loud on my reading time, I say, God, I don't really like that verse. And that's okay. It's all right. You don't have to be nervous to say that stuff to God. It doesn't make God nervous. And so I would say, you know, I don't like this. He goes, all right, fine. I'll make you read it every day. It says, count it all, brethren, count it all joy. Everybody say joy. When you fall into various trials. That's the part I don't like. Count it all joy. Why should I have joy in the middle of my trials? Well, he tells us in verse 3, knowing that the testing of your faith, everybody say faith, produces patience. But let patience, you could also put the word endurance in there. You could put steadfastness in there. It says, but let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect or mature and complete, that means whole, lacking nothing, that means full. Now notice what the Bible says. It says, testing of your faith. The testing of your faith produces patience. Now, Romans 10, verse 17 says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So the Bible says faith comes by hearing. Well, how does it grow? How does our faith grow? Our faith grows by it being tested. And the most important characteristic that you can have in association with our faith is patience. That's why it says that count it all joy when you fall into various trials, because God knows that your faith has enough patience to make it through the storm that you're dealing with. If you didn't have any faith, then there would be no storm. Now that's a great, I hope you heard what I just said. If you're dealing with a storm in your life right now, it's because God knows that your faith can handle it. You have enough faith in order to deal with your storm. And so I know many of us in this room today are dealing with a little banana peel. We're dealing with a lot of banana peel. Maybe we're in the midst of an epic fall, strapped with 2,000 pounds of TNT around us, trying to chase a dream that seems uncatchable. But the truth is that God is with you. God's presence is for you. And I want to look at that today. I want to look about how to make it through that storm. In Mark chapter 4 is the culmination of one day. We're going to start reading in verse 30 in just a second. But this is the culmination of one day in the life of Jesus that started back in Mark chapter 3. And so I thought about this. I said, you know, what if Jesus tweeted this day? What would it sound like? How many of y'all know what Twitter is? Follow me at Troy A. Maxwell. And so if you don't know what Twitter is, before you leave today, you need to find somebody that looks 20 and ask them what Twitter is and come out of your coma. I'm just kidding. If he tweeted, this is what I think it would sound like. Instead of me going back and reading Mark chapter 3 all the way through chapter 4, if he tweeted, this is what he would say. The first tweet happened early in the morning, 8:24 a.m. This is Jesus tweeting. This is his Twitter account. Went to church today. Guy's hand was messed up, healed him, and the deacons wanted to kill me. That was tweet number one. His second tweet, there's seven of them. His second tweet sounded something like this. It happened at 9:45 a.m. Went to the beach. Tons of people followed. Played volleyball. Cast out some devils. Waves were small. It's my message. This is what I think Jesus would tweet. Tweet number three, 11:30 a.m. Jesus is tweeting of his day. Had my first life group meeting with 12 guys. Man, I got some work to do. Got a couple of EGRs in the group. If you don't know what an EGR, it means extra grace required. If you've ever been in a life group and you don't, let's just leave that alone. Yeah. Tweet number four, 2:02 p.m. This is Jesus' tweet at 2 o'clock. He says, family showed up and said I was out of my mind. LOL. This is Jesus if he tweeted. Tweet number five, 3:30 p.m. Same guys who tried to kill me at church followed me out here and started calling me the devil. Tweet number six, 5:30 p.m. Emergency life group meeting with the 12. Needed to tell them some important things and straighten some stuff out. Tweet number seven, 7 p.m., exhausted, got in a boat to go to the other side, need a nap, ZZZZZ. That's a day in the life of the Twitter account of Jesus. All right, now let's read the Bible. Mark chapter 4, Jesus gives four parables at the end of this day. And it's really cool to watch kind of how his day goes, because it doesn't go all that well. Jesus is now at the end. He's having this life group meeting, and he shares four different parables. The last parable, however, is where he gives a parable And then the very next thing that happens is actually a demonstration of the parable that he gives. Now let's read the parable, verse 30. It says, "Then he said, 'To what shall I liken the kingdom of God?'" In other words, God's saying, listen, what is it like in the kingdom of God? What is it like for you to experience the kingdom of God? Jesus is telling us this is what our life is like as we experience the kingdom of God. Or, same verse, with what parable or story shall we picture it? Give me a snapshot of what the kingdom of God looks like. Verse 31, "It is like a mustard seed." Everybody say mustard seed. Now, when the Bible ever uses the term mustard seed, it's referencing our faith. So in other words, you can say he's speaking about yours and my faith. He says, "It is like our faith, a mustard seed, which, when it is sown on the ground, is smaller than all the seeds on the earth." Now, if you remember, Jesus also talked about mustard seed faith, and he said that it's really, really small, but it doesn't matter how big your faith is, because the smaller the faith, the more powerful it is. Just as if you have faith, it's enough to move mountains, to speak to this mountain, tell it to jump in the sea, jump out of the sea, whatever. Your faith is like a mustard seed. If I had a mustard seed in my hand right now, you wouldn't be able to see it. But listen to what he goes on to say. He says, "But when it is sown," or when your faith is used or exercised. It says, "When you use your faith, it grows up and becomes greater than all herbs and shoots out large branches so that the birds," now underline that in your Bible, "the birds of the air may nest under its shade." So what Jesus is telling us right here, he says, listen, whenever the Bible uses the word birds, he's talking about the enemy. He's talking about Satan. All through the scriptures, whenever a bird is referenced, he's talking about Satan. So here's what God's saying. God's saying, if you have faith that is exercised, you're going to face attacks from the enemy, where the birds of the air are going to come and try to mess with your faith. So in other words, he's saying, if you don't have any birds messing with you, then you don't have any faith. So if you say, I'm going through a major storm, a major challenge in my life, it's because you have enough faith to overcome it. God trusts you enough to be able to, you can handle this problem. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, it says that there is no temptation that has ever come into man's world that God doesn't know about and that you can't handle. So here's the good thing. You may not like it right now, but the fact is you've got enough faith if you're in the middle of a storm to make it through. Now the demonstration. Look at verse 35. "On the same day when evening had come, he said to them, 'Let us cross over to the other side.'" That Jesus gets in this boat that he had asked them to prepare back in Mark chapter 3. "Now when," verse 36, "they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose," big banana peel appeared, "and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. And he," Jesus, "was in the stern asleep on a pillow." What? Asleep. "And they awoke him and said to him, 'Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?'" Another translation said, "We're going to die, Jesus." "Then he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, 'Peace, be still.' And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, 'Why are you so fearful?'" Talking to the disciples. "How is it that you have no faith? Wherever fear is present, there is no faith. Wherever faith is present, there is no fear." You say, well, hold on. There's areas of my life where I'm fearful, and there's areas of life where I have faith. Wherever the faith is present, there is no fear. Faith is the inoculation or the injection that we need in order to overcome every fear that we have. "And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, 'Who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him?'" Three things I want you to know in the middle of your storm about the napping Jesus. Number one, write this down. It's time to go to the other side. Hit your neighbor and say, it's time to go to the other side. Notice what Jesus says in verse 35. Notice what he says. He says, "Let us cross over to the other side." Now, You can look at that and go, oh, Jesus is just being nice and they just need to get in the boat and go to the other side. But the truth is this wasn't a suggestion from God. This one, the language, the original language, remember the Old Testament was written in Hebrew, the New Testament was written in? The Greek text here is an imperative and a directive from God. He's not giving them an option to go to the other side. He says, let us go to the other side. You need to get away from where you are into a new place that I want to take you to. Yep. There is an other side for you. This is more than a geographical location. This is more than just somewhere that we God wants to take you and just leave you. This is more than just a new house and a new city. This is way bigger than that. So let me ask you the question. Have you thought about what your other side is? Have you thought about maybe God is pressing you, pushing you, saying it's time to go to the other side. Maybe the other side in your marriage. Maybe the other side in your relationships. Maybe the other side in your ministry. Maybe the other side in your finances. Maybe God is kind of pushing you, saying, not suggesting, not saying, hey, maybe we can, you know, take a sack lunch and try to work our way to the other side. It is time to go to the other side. Notice what he says in verse 36. If you want to go to the other side, verse 36, now when they had left the multitude. If you want to go to the other side, you might have to step away from the crowd. You got to get away from some people in your life that want to hold you on this side because they're afraid of the pressure of you being on the other side and they might have to change. Come on. Come on, hit your neighbor and say, let's go to the other side. Now, let me just tell you about the other side. Let me tell you about the other. Getting there is going to be a challenge. But you have faith as a mustard seed. And sure, the birds are going to come and try to nest under the exercising of your faith. But that's all right. That's all right. You got Jesus in your boat. Come on, hit your neighbor and say, he might be asleep, but at least he's in the boat. Right? It's time to go to the other side. Verse 37, and when a great windstorm arose and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling, but he, Jesus, was in the stern asleep on a pillow. Now, I love this story because in this whole little encounter, I can see the humanity and the deity of Jesus all in one short little thing. I see his humanity. He's tired. He's had a tough day. I mean, he had the deacons called him the devil. He played volleyball on the shore, cast out devils. His family called him crazy. He had a dysfunctional 12 guys. One of them, you know, trying to pickpocket everybody. Judas, Thomas is crying, going, we ain't going to make it. I don't think we're going to make it. Peter's cussing. I mean, it's just not a good thing. I've been to some life groups where there's been that kind of stuff going, people stealing stuff and people cussing. That makes for a good life group right there. You know you got a good life group when that happens. Somebody's like, what are you talking about? This is supposed to be church. And they awoke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? This speaks of his deity because he has the ability to sleep in the middle of a storm. The storm didn't wake him. The disciples did. Yeah. They awoke him. Good. They're the ones that... And so, here's the second thing. It's time to go to the other side. Here's the second. Storms can be a setup. Think about your storm for a second. Maybe it's a setup. Maybe God has you in the middle of your storm setting you up so your faith... See, storms are meant to grow us spiritually. You say, hold on a second. Can't God just kind of download it like the Matrix, just plug it in the back of my head and just I can just automatically have all the spiritual maturity? No, you got to go through some stuff. You won't know what kind of faith you have until you've been through a storm. You won't know how strong your faith is until your boat starts rocking a little bit and still things start getting a little choppy and the winds start blowing a little bit. Jesus is asleep. Remember, he's still in the boat. He might be asleep. And sometimes we feel like that. We feel like Jesus is asleep. But you can just go down there, shake him. Jesus, I feel like I'm dying. He's going to wake up. Oh, I can take care of this. I can take care of this for you. Storms can be a setup because, listen, God wants to be awakened in your life. He wants to wake up in your life. He wants to be awakened in who you are in every circumstance. He wants to be involved in your marriage, involved in your finances, involved in your relationship, involved in your college campus, involved in your high school, involved. All you got to do is just waiting for you to wake him up. He's waiting for you to wake him up with your worship, waiting for you to wake him up with your prayers, waiting for you to wake him up with your tenacity and just pressing and saying, I'm not going to give up. I'm going to the other side. I'm going to make it to the other side. I'm going to do it. No storm, no devil in hell is going to throw out any banana peels or any kind of storm to stop me from having the marriage that God's called me to be. No devil in hell is going to stop me from starting this business. All economic stuff can come against me, but I'm doing it because I have a dream. I'm going to the other side. Storms can be a setup to grow your faith, to grow your faith. I love what the Bible says in 1 Peter 4:12. It says, friends, when life gets really difficult, don't jump to the conclusion that God isn't on the job. That's one of those scriptural keepers right there. God's on the job. He's taking care of it. Here's the third thing that I want you to hear today. It's never the what, but always the who. It's never the what, but always the who. Your faith, write this down. Faith is not believing for something. Because if you believe for something, more than likely you will get disappointed. Because the something may not be what you're trying. You may not need that something. But if you'll keep your trust, if you and I will keep our trust in the who, the someone, and trust that he knows the something, then our faith will always have its directive in the right way. We'll always have the way. We always know which way we need to go when our faith is in someone, not in something. So it's not the what that we need. It's the who. It's always the who. And listen to what Jesus says when he arose, verse 39. He arose. And I want you to underline this in your Bible because he gives us basically a pattern in dealing with our own personal storms. He says in verse 39, then he arose. Notice what he did. He arose and he rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. Notice what he did. He rebuked. Underline that word rebuked. Because in the original language, in the Greek, this was a word that Jesus used in order to deal with demonic forces. Back in Mark chapter 1, verse 25, when he was dealing with a demon, he rebuked that demon and cast it out of that man. This is the same word that he uses right here because he's dealing. Notice, what did he rebuke? He rebuked the wind. Can you see wind? No. Now you can see the effects of it, but you can't see the wind. You know what? What Jesus was telling us is that if we want to see our storm change, we've got to deal with what we can't see before we deal with what we can see. He rebuked the wind and then spoke to the sea. You can't see the wind, but you can see the sea. And so he said, I'm going to deal with these spiritual forces that are actually controlling the natural things, the circumstances. You see all the sea bouncing around. You see the boat bouncing up and down. But peace, Jesus says. I believe, honestly, when he said, peace, be still, he said, peace to the disciples, be still to the storm. Because Jesus' peace is different than any other peace. It's not just, matter of fact, Jesus made this statement in John chapter 14, verse 27. He says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives peace. And then he says, now, don't let your heart be troubled or don't be anxious for things because the peace that I want to give you, the peace that I want to live inside of you, not a circumstantial peace, not a, you know what, it looks like everything's going to be okay. I guess we can just, you know, kind of relax. No, it's a peace that gets inside of you, a peace that drives you. A peace that you can see the waves getting larger and larger and larger, but you know inside that God's got you. A peace that means confidence, that when you speak to that storm, it's going to change. When you rebuke the wind, when you deal with those spiritual forces, you know that God, you may not see it in the first day, the first 5 days, the first week, the first month, the first year. You may not see the change immediately, but you know God is working behind the scenes. You can't see it, but you know He's doing it. He's taking care of it. He's working. You're not going to quit on that marriage because you know God is working. You're not going to quit praying. You're not going to quit worshiping. You're not going to quit coming to church just because you didn't get a microwave circumstance change. You're going to keep pressing and keep pressing. That's the kind of peace that He gives us. He gives us that peace, a peace that means that I'm confident, a peace that means that I'm secure in who I am, my identity. I'm confident I'm a child of God. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He formed me before I was in my mother's womb. He knew me way before that. I am His workmanship created in Christ Jesus. That's who God made me. And I'm confident and I'm secure in who I am. That's the kind of peace that He gives us. The kind of peace that says that I have courage. Courage. More than just boldness, but courage. Courage to stand up to everything and everyone who may be sinking in their storm. You know what I love about this story? Is there's a little phrase in here that I didn't see for the longest time. Because I was so focused on the boat with the disciples, I didn't realize that in verse 36, it says that, and other little boats were also with Him. The faith that the disciples, the miracle that Jesus performed didn't just affect the boat that the disciples were in. But every other boat that was around them was influenced by the calming of the storm. Your success or your overcoming your storm just doesn't affect you. It affects all of the little boats. All of those people, all of those things that you're dealing with. Your influence is so powerful in the middle of your storm. Peace. That means fulfillment. Peace, that means hope. Peace. And then He says, be still. Again, he's dealing with the demonic forces that have thrown the banana peel in front of him, that have pushed the storm in front of him. And Jesus is right there. And he said, you know, he says to the disciples, you know, this is his life group, man. He's struggling. They're struggling. He says, why are you so fearful? Why are you so afraid? Don't you have any faith? Don't you know who's in the boat with you? That's why they said, who can this be? I love Philippians 1:6, and I'll just finish with this. Philippians 1:6, it says, being confident of this very thing. This one translation says this one thing. Being confident of this one thing, that He who, not what, but He who has begun a good work in you will complete it. It may not happen tomorrow. It may not happen next week. But I'm confident. I have the peace of God that everything's going to be all right. Everything's going to be okay. We're going to make it through this storm. We're going to get to the other side. You know where they were going? You know where they were going? It says that we're going to a place called Gergesene. Your Bible may say the Gadarene area. You know what Gadarene means? Reward. It means treasured thing. Isn't that powerful to think? That when you get to the other side is when you experience the reward of the overcoming power of Jesus on the inside of you. Let me pray for you. Father, in Jesus' name, we're so grateful for Your presence that's here today. God, we love You so much. God, I pray for every person that is in the middle of their personal sea, being tossed to and fro and back and forth, up and down, all over the place. And God, You're in the boat with them. And Father, whether awake or asleep, Your presence is there. Father, let us be reminded that Your presence is here. Even now, God, we can sense Your presence. Your presence. We need Your presence. We need Your presence. We need Your peace. A peace that passes all understanding. not as the world gives, but as you give, God. Lord Jesus, come into our life. Come into our boat and bring that peace, hope, courage, confidence, security, and fulfillment. Your peace. I speak your peace over these circumstances. In Jesus' name. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here today, maybe you haven't invited Jesus into your boat and you want to. Maybe you've been running from him for a long time and trying to steer your boat by yourself. Maybe today's the day. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know where you are in life, but I know that you can start over. I did it 22 years ago. I invited Jesus into my life, into my boat. His presence has guided me through challenges of alcoholism, coming out of that as a young man, facing the multitudes in my life. And because of his peace, I was able to overcome those challenges, overcome those storms. I can tell you storm after storm after storm that I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for Jesus in my boat. Maybe you need to invite him into your boat. Maybe he once was in your life, but you ran away from him. Doesn't matter why. Doesn't matter what you did, because the Bible tells us that it's his blood that forgives us of all that stuff. It cleanses us of all those mistakes that we may have done in our life. And today you can walk out of this place forgiven and free from shame, free from guilt. You can start over right now. I want to pray with you. If that's you, would you allow me to lead you in a prayer, a declaration? If you say, that's me, I want to get right with Jesus today. Church, would you join with them as we make this declaration? Just say this with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe that you died for me. I believe that your blood was shed for me. Come into my life. Get in my boat. Help me, God. Save me. Change me. Deliver me. Heal me. Set me free. In the name of Jesus, I receive you, Lord, into my life right now. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a clap and just thank him. Come on, give the Lord a big clap and just love on him. Well, it's been a great day today. So glad that you came to church today. Make sure as you're leaving, we have these little things of popcorn we'd love to give you so you can invite some people. If you do have a DVR, DVR, and then come out tonight to Andy Cherry worship night. It's going to be phenomenal. The doors open at 6:30. Everything kicks off at 7 o'clock. It's going to be amazing. I'm going to be here. Can't wait. So love you guys. Slap three people a high five and say, I'm going to the other side. You may be dismissed. God bless you.